Thank you everyone for going with us. This feels like a really good space for us to continue on with the studio visit. The next part of this is Rachel and I invited Rachel to think about who she would want to invite as a critical respondent, as someone who engages with the work from another angle, and she was so excited to invite Julia Felsenthal, and it's been a real pleasure watching. I only got to partake in the early conversation, but I'm really excited to welcome Julia to the stage, and she's going to share some thoughts with us, please.
Okay, I'm going to sit down. Nervous public speaker, something to know, and this is a very large theater. So I am a writer for Vogue, mostly for the website, and I write mostly about more pop cultural things, and I don't write a lot about theater. So when Rachel asked me to do this, I said sure, but to explain that would be sort of the angle that I would be coming from. So that's my fair warning to you guys. So when I agreed to write about the bumps, I began thinking in earnest about the cultural territory that pregnancy currently occupies. And on the one hand, we've come a very long way since the days when Lucille Ball wasn't permitted by CBS Brass to utter the word pregnant on I Love Lucy, though she in her own way broke ground by writing her second pregnancy into the plotline of her show. On the other hand, we haven't come so far at all. We live in an age in which long-held norms of what constitutes appropriate pregnant behavior are being renegotiated, and in some cases radically upended, in others simply monitored more closely and more broadly than ever before. In 2015, the comedian Ali Wong jumped from the B-list to the A-list when she filmed an exceptionally filthy stand-up special for Netflix at 7.5 months pregnant. Last spring, Serena Williams won the Australian Open while secretly in the first trimester of her pregnancy. Last winter, Beyonce, at the time pregnant with twins, performed at the Grammys for a stretch wearing only a bikini, fashioning herself as a sort of fertility goddess. And some saw that less as a straight up performance than as a commentary on performance itself, or rather on the expectation society places on pregnant women to be constantly enacting ideals of motherhood. The author Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie took a different tack on the same matter when in an interview with the Financial Times last year, she slyly revealed a baby whose existence the world had never quite clocked. I just feel like we live in an age when women are supposed to perform pregnancy, Adichie explained of her choice to keep a very low profile. We don't expect fathers to perform fatherhood. In her memoir, The Argonauts, which Rachel made me read before giving this speech, Maggie Nelson put it like this: it's humdrum but relentless, the obsession with who's pregnant and who's showing and whose life is transforming due to the imminent arrival of the all-miraculous, all-coveted baby, all of which flips in the blink of an eye into an obsession with how soon all signs of bearing the life-transforming baby can evaporate, how soon the mother's career, sex life, weight can be restored, as if nothing ever happened here at all. Consider the body shaming that Kim Kardashian received during her first pregnancy. Consider just a couple weeks ago when rumors emerged that three Kardashian Jenner sisters were simultaneously expecting and the internet could speak of nothing else. Our celebrity pregnancy obsession is a reflection of a broader preoccupation with monitoring women's behavior, with controlling their bodies. I can't speak up here and not mention that just this week, Republicans introduced yet another bill attempting to roll back protections enshrined by Roe versus Wade. And just this afternoon, President Trump moved to remove federal requirements that employers include birth control coverage in their health insurance plans. Over the course of a week in early September, two events transpired that struck me as significant to this conversation. First, on September 8th, the designers Zoe Lada and Mike Eckhouse of the line Eckhouse Lada staged their spring 2018 fashion show in Bushwick, and among those models they sent down the runway was the artist Maya Ruth Lee, who just so happened to have been 8 months pregnant at the time. Lee was not the first pregnant model to make an appearance at a fashion week. Expecting mothers have walked before for Dolce & Gabbana, Chanel, Jean Paul Gaultier, Victoria's Secret, but there was something different here. In the past, the vision of motherhood on display felt proper, restrained, buttoned up. Ashley Good walked in a wedding gown for Chanel, Bianca Balti wore an office-ready silk sheath for Dolce & Gabbana, even a second trimester Rina Shayk walking for Victoria's Secret wore something that for Victoria's Secret was quite demure. There was a sense in each of these cases that we were witnessing a coincidence of poor timing. These women had been included in spite of, not because of, their altered state. Not so for Lee, who was dressed in a lilac-colored cardigan dress, literally left unbuttoned around her midsection to allow her naked belly to protrude through. She appeared simultaneously like the pregnant woman that she was and like a woman who was giving birth to her own pregnant belly. This was far more radical than maternity wear. It was idiosyncratic, subjective, empowered. The fashion wasn't wearing the model was hacking the fashion. The other thing, and I apologize because I'm about to spoil the movie Mother for you, but the other thing that happened about a week later is that the director, Darren Aronofsky, released his new movie, Mother. Aronofsky's film is a mashup of Old Testament plot lines, creation, Cain and Abel, Noah's Ark, molded into a murkily allegorical tale about a famous poet played by Javier Bardem and his beautiful young wife played by Jennifer Lawrence, who live together in the generically remote countryside in a rambling old house that he owns and that she has remodeled to perfection, mostly so that he has a nice place to write his next collection of poetry. Things go awry when unwelcome guests arrive who turn out to be super fans of the poet and who disrupt Lawrence's insistent homemaking efforts. Things go really haywire when she gets pregnant and close to full term, is horrified to discover that her husband has invited hordes of these sycophants to take up residence in their house. Thus begins a hellish montage of destruction as the outside world intrudes on this woman-made paradise, upends Lawrence's attempts at domesticity, and shortly after she gives birth, speaking in the metaphors that Aronofsky favors, destroys the fruits of that labor as well. That's the film's most controversial scene. Its most progressive scene is probably the last, when it's revealed that Lawrence, the ill-begotten baby, the whole of this universe, are really just the poet's creation. Eve, even the Stepford version of Eve, may fancy herself an architect of her own destiny, may imagine herself an actor in her own narrative, but in Aronofsky's vision, she's really just a literary device, an object in a man's story, the product of a business deal between God and Adam. Critics have postulated many theories of mother, but most acknowledge the strangely antique and quite frankly masculinist politics that undergird the film. Man makes woman, woman makes baby. Man makes art, man's enormous ego destroys woman and baby. No space exists for female ambition, for female subjectivity. In an interview, Aronofsky explained that Mother was meant to be a parable about climate change. Bardem is God, Lawrence as Mother Earth, humanity as well, humanity. Maybe. In any case, it's clear that we're supposed to see the poet as a foil for the director, the auteur. That this film itself is the product of an enormous male ego, bolstered by Paramount, which gave Aronofsky $30 million to realize his vision, is presumably meant to be part of the joke. That the film bombed, both with critics and at the box office, and Aronofsky will nonetheless likely receive a blank check from Paramount or another major studio to make his next film, seems like a broader cosmic joke on women. Consider that against the backdrop of a recent New Yorker story by Jessica Winter titled Why Aren't Mothers Worth Anything to Venture Capitalists? Winter wrote about the $700 million breast pump market, long dominated by a single imperfect product, and the attempts of an entrepreneur named Janica Alvarez to build a company around a more innovative offering. During fundraising, Alvarez reported that she endured comments from possible investors about her body and questions about her ability to run a startup with three young children. She was only able to raise $6.5 million, a measly sum in the world of venture capital. Venture capitalists, Winter writes, do not appear to share my enthusiasm for breast pump hashtag disruption, perhaps because the industry is 93% male. What are the takeaways here? We live in a capitalist society in which it is assumed that the logic of markets will prevail, but often it does not. We live in a patriarchal society in which we assume that the way things have been done is the way they should be done and always must be done, and we probably should not. Too often we fail to question who assigns value, who wrote the rules we live by, whether those rules are ones we ought to keep on obeying. Which brings me to the bumps and its radical vision. I first saw Rachel's play last summer when she invited me to a staged reading put on as a fundraiser for Planned Parenthood by a pregnant Broadway actor who was Googling around looking for something she could perform and who stumbled on this project. In some ways, that was the perfect introduction to the bumps because it demonstrates the way that a really provocative idea like this one can take on a life of its own. A lot of plays are political in their content, Rachel told me when we sat down to discuss her project a few weeks ago, but I think it's more interesting when they're structurally subversive. The bumps is both. When the play opens, we see three pregnant women waiting in a waiting room. If you're like me, you automatically jump to the conclusion that this must be a doctor's office, because why else would three pregnant strangers be in a room together? It is not a doctor's office, of course, as you saw, and that assumption is the type of circuit that the bumps works hard to short. First and foremost, this is a play about pregnancy, written in consultation with pregnant women, that reflects the anxieties and realities and joys of expectant motherhood. Zoom out a little bit, and you'll see that this is a play written specifically for pregnant women to act in an attempt to redress a wrong, a system that essentially writes women actors out of the workforce for at the very least two trimesters of their pregnancies, and in many cases for the first years of motherhood as well. Zoom out again or get your hand on the script and you'll see that this is a play not only about the experience of pregnancy, but one meant to be shaped by the vagaries of being pregnant. As Rachel writes of her approach, if our rehearsals have a mantra, it would sound like this. This play doesn't exist in the immutable abstract. It exists to be a frame for wherever you are. So wherever you are is perfect. It is interesting. It is our starting place today. Zoom out again and you'll see that Rachel has drawn an urgent connection between the ephemerality of live performance, the very reason we might seek it out over television or film, and the ephemerality of childbearing, and in so doing questions why pregnancy with its built-in sense of drama wouldn't be actually the ideal backdrop for theater. Zoom out one last time and you'll realize that the bumps offers a template for how we might radically renovate the structure of any industry to make it work better for women. It's probably worth mentioning that this is an idea that very much speaks to me. I'm about to turn 34. I'm facing the narrowing window of my own fertility, the open question of what I will have to give up to become a mother. I'm a workaholic journalist who wonders if I can possibly balance my career with a baby. I'm the daughter of a workaholic journalist who wonders if I can improve upon the version of motherhood that my own mother was able to provide. And I'm a person who is very much absorbed from our culture the fear that it may not be possible to nurture both my creative ambitions and a child. What kind of messages would I have absorbed in a world that better reflected the values embedded in the bumps? Who knows? Maybe my kids, or at the very least your kids, will be better equipped to say. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. And we're actually going to invite the team up to the stage. I think the actresses can join us now as well, if they'd like to. We're going to take, just 10 minutes to have a little conversation between everyone here. I actually want to start with, I'll grab that so that you all can talk, because that's who they're here to see. I'm wondering if the two of you, Rachel and Julia, have any questions for each other, since this was a moment for you to share something with each other. I don't think she read what you wrote beforehand, right?
Yeah.
Great. Well, I will hand the mic.
I guess one question that I have, I was so moved, Julia, by your personal story that you shared at the end of your really beautiful essay, and something that I think happens through the bumps is that we all end up talking a lot about ourselves and where we're at, and I just wonder with your own writing, is that something that you always do, or is that something that has been a side effect of the bumps as it has, I think, been for all of us? Yeah.
So you mean, do I always reflect personally?
Yeah.
I don't always reflect personally. This felt like a opportunity to do so, but also not that there was an expectation that I'd do so, but it's a it's a very, very personal piece, and we talked a lot about personal stuff when we sat down and had coffee to talk about this project. But I also do try to, I mean, I think one of the advantages of writing on the internet where words are not, you know, where you have as much space as you want, is that if you want to frame something in terms of your own experience, there's space to do that, and I think that people, generally speaking, respond more to that than if you try to speak from some voice from on high, which I feel uncomfortable doing to begin with. So, I don't know if that answers
it. I'm really grateful for that, and I think through this whole process with each of you guys, it's not something that we're asking for in an audition, but it is so meaningful that you guys have gone along with the Bumps journey and like shared your vulnerabilities, your hard days, what does a hard day of pregnancy look like? I feel like this is a project where the least amount of professional language comes into the conversation, and it's so real. I mean, like, pregnancy just is undeniably real and emotional and vulnerable and personal, and so I was so moved to see that come through in your essay, too. Yeah, so now you guys all have to share about your personal lives. No, I'm just kidding. Well, that was my question for you.
Okay. I don't have a question teed up.
That's fine. If you want to process one. Does anyone in the audience have any questions for anyone that we're so lucky to have here? Yeah.
I'm just wondering, Rachel, what's behind the movement?
What's behind the movement?
Yeah, well, Dina, I think, do you want to answer this question, Dina? I can give it a crack first, and then do you want to fill in the gaps? So, first, I think Dina and I both knew that this project couldn't just be language-based. And throughout this whole process, Dina has very wisely been reminding me of that, because I'm coming from a place of language. But, so, when we were first designing this project, we knew there ought to be a balance. But those movement moments are about, so the larger play does kind of ask you to think about the generations of pregnancy. So you have one actor playing themselves, playing their unborn child in a way, or looking from that vantage point out, and then playing your own daughters grown up. So there are these interludes, these movement interludes, where you kind of see actors as themselves, and you see actors playing all of these people at the same time, and these movements become kind of motifs that replay, so that we are reminded of when we're in the second act of parents, and then when they're in the third act. So they become connectors between all the generations. It's kind of a subconscious place, in the same way that we are subconsciously connected to our mothers, the next generation, in a way that we don't fully know.
So act two of this piece, which this is the fifth group of Bumps that we've worked with over the last 2 years, and so we've done one full staging of it. Act two, they are in bikinis and snorkels and goggles and headgear, and they're literally their daughters in utero, and it's essentially a 15-minute dance piece of women, pregnant women in bikinis being amazing. And so what you're seeing, what we're hinting at in this over a 1 week period, what we're hinting at is what you end up seeing in act two. So the idea is you might in act one be like, what are they doing? But a couple minutes later, wait 20 minutes, and all of a sudden you go, oh, that's what their kids are doing in that exact moment. So it's kind of like a flash forward that you don't realize the context for a half hour.
This is a question that I'm so excited to ask, because actually going through pregnancy herself, and this is Minx has made this experience so meaningful for all of us. And so I want to know, just how has directing felt for you this go around? How has it changed?
My mom, I think, is watching the live stream, so she's very excited. she knows. it's interesting, when we did the benefit for Planned Parenthood in August, I was pregnant also, but couldn't say anything about it because of the statistic of 1 in 4 doesn't go through, so I was just trying not to puke and rehearsing at all times.
And I was like, why is Dina eating snacks? She never eats snacks.
So this time it was really special. I mean, I was joking the other day, I'm like, I feel like I'm with the big girls. Just being able to ask questions and being part of a process in a way that I haven't been before. And as a director, that's really important to me, to be vulnerable and to ask questions and to be in a place where you're asking as many questions as the actors might be. And so it was just really exciting because we've been in this for so long. And I was experiencing it in a new way and like feeling things in a new way, and certain lines of like just stuck out more of the first, it ruins food, and watching Ying just like her feelings at a banana, I'm like, oh, I know what that is now, so now I can explain that. And I think just in general for the directors in the audience that you might share with me that challenge of when you're directing something that you haven't experienced.
I appreciated that in your introduction you talked about your book and the projection of the feminist utopia, and it helped me in watching the piece and hearing you talk about the piece how much that was its own thoroughly designed utopian vision. And what I would love to hear from any of you on the team is, how does that project outward? How does that rehearsal room, how does that way of working that seems so important to the way that you make this work, can you carry that into other projects? Have you found that you were able to?
Yes. So I'm not an actor. I want to start with that. This is the first thing that I've acted in as an adult outside of being in like an elementary school play. And so but as an artist, a lot of my work, especially as of recently, has involved me being on camera. And so before I started The Bumps, I had shot a pilot for something, and I was like, oh God, I'm like 3 months pregnant. It's still cute now, you know, nobody knows, but if this show gets picked up, what's gonna happen? Are they still gonna want me to come back? Are they gonna let me be on camera and be pregnant? So it's interesting that you brought up Lucille Ball, because I made it a point during shooting to like talk about, I think it was Carol Burnett and like being pregnant on television, or maybe it was Joan Rivers being the first pregnant comedian. And I like made it a point to be like, yeah, pregnant women have been discriminated against and they can't be on TV, but now they can, so don't be assholes and like let them come back. And trying to manifest this utopian ideal of like being a working pregnant woman. And it doesn't even have to be a part of what you're doing. You just happen to be pregnant, because we have to show up for ourselves and our child and everyone else every single day. And so, yes, this really gave me, I might be deviating from whatever you asked, but this really gave me like the strength and like a good support system of women to see other creatives do it and show up and know that it can be done and know that we can still be ourselves in the midst of like not being ourselves at all, like being whole new people. So this has been fantastic. This, and I'll conclude with this, I had a friend who's in the audience now who asked me like, are you in therapy? Because you know, you got a lot going on. You're like doing all these things as we do as women, as then especially to compound that with being artists. And I said, you know, well, my work is my therapy. Coming here and being able to be at work and also talk about the fact that I've got that weird tingly thing at the top, and do you have that tingly thing? And, oh, this hurts, and oh my God, my doctor just called me and said I'm anemic, what the fuck? And, you know, and that I can do all of that and still be working and still be respected and still work on my craft and expand is really ideal.
Thank you for sharing that. Something that, in answer to your question, Andrew, that I know Dean and I talk a lot about is childcare for the audience, which is something that we had never done for, we worked together before the bumps, but is something that we brought on with this project. And since that's happened, both of us have started wondering, well, why is that just for a project about pregnancy? Shouldn't that be for every single play, for every single cultural activity? It's the kind of, I think every lesson that I've learned through the bumps, we can't unsee. Similarly, like caring for the body, caring for people's emotions, there's no getting around that with the bumps. That has to be a part of it. But I think it makes everything better starting from that point.
I think it
connects to everything we do in theater. I think the lessons from this project.
Yeah, I know I've carried it, and it's something that I ask for when I find out. I'm like, oh, you have a child? Okay, well, are you cool? Like, do they want to come and do homework in the back? That it's a conversation that needs to happen. And it is a question, and it's interesting, both here and at the Scribble Cultural Center in Los Angeles, when we mentioned it, it wasn't a big deal. Both institutions were like, oh yeah, we can figure something out. And we're like, oh, I don't want more people do this. I know a lot of work goes into it. I don't want to pretend it doesn't, but, And Jennifer Chang, who's a director and actor in LA, and she's runs the acting program at UCSD. She was on a panel we did at round two of the bumps, and she was saying a big change was she and her husband met and fell in love doing cultural activities. And so that was what they did. They went and saw things together as a couple, and then once they had children, they had to take turns. So the dates weren't happening anymore, and she was the one that she came. She brought her kid, and one of them wanted to color in the back with childcare, and the other one wanted to sit on mom's lap. So he did. But it was really interesting, just even talking about the dynamic between partners. And I know my partner and I were talking about that, about you know what will date them. We were talking about it the other day. We were saying. How, as cultural institutions, and I see leaders in this audience, what can we do to help date night keep happening?
I first have to say I know that my wife is watching the stream right now because she's home with our kids. So, and I was really sad that she couldn't see this. I know she'd love it. Yeah, I mean, it's well past that. Any other questions? Yeah.
In the first act, all the characters identify very neatly in a kind of like 80s gender binary. And then in the second act, it's just about bodies and no definitions of gender. And then in the third act, which is set today, you see their children all grown up, and their gender identities aren't so strict, I should say. But I will say that something I think a lot about with Utopia is from having worked on the Feminist Utopia Project, this comes directly from an idea from James Baldwin, is that utopias are definitely a reflection of you and your dreams and our current reality. You can only see so far, and behind every utopia, once you never arrive at utopia, because once you get there, there's a new utopian vision. And so in this play, in the first act, you kind of see this a little bit, but all of the characters have dreams, and those dreams are reflections of a very capitalist society. And I think we take those dreams seriously, but also it's much easier to see in the first act how flawed those dreams are. You know, they want property, they want families, they want nuclear families, they want financial, you know, the idea of having a big, like being affiliated with a big company and being able to move to the city's dreams that I think we now know are not necessarily the dreams to strive for. So in the third act, the characters also have dreams, but they are structured in parallel to those dreams in the first act. So my hope is that you would watch those and know that in some ways they're also not necessarily false, but incomplete, that they'll continue to evolve, and that those aren't like objective dreams or like goals that we should all have necessarily, that dreams continue to evolve. I think something that this project asks is, what does it mean to wait? What does it mean to want something of our future? So your question, like, is the question. And I hope this doesn't feel like an answer, but a way to ask. Or not, no, yes, I hope it bumps doesn't feel like an answer. But it's like engaging with that question. Yeah.
I feel like that's actually a really great place to wrap things up. I want to thank you all. I feel really honored that you took tonight to bring this project, to share a moment of it, to situate it for us, to give your critical thoughts, and all of you for joining us. So thank you so much. There's no graceful way to segue from such thoughtful beauty to what I'm about to say. But we have to have a closing night party to this festival, and it just so happens to be at a virtual reality bar and arcade right around the corner called VR World. So I'm sorry, I can't even believe I did that. So we want you all, after you take a moment to talk to each other, to talk to the artists, to just grab your things, and you're gonna join us around the corner at VR World. It's on 34th Street, and there we're gonna celebrate this festival, these 3 days that have been such a joy. So I hope we'll see you there, and again, thank you to the artists for closing us out so wonderfully.